of the east coast of the west coast of the US. I'm not a geographer, so that's fine. So James won the Meteorological Society MIR Prize in 2014. He also won the Hootsman's Medal of the European Association of Geochemistry in the same year. He was a former undergraduate and PhD student here at the University of Durham. So we're very pleased to have him back. I'm also very lucky that James was a mentor to me during my postdoctoral work when I was in the US, at which time he was working at the University of Maryland with Richard Walker and the team. And so without further ado, James, if you'd like to
Thank you, Amy. Well, I have to say it's a real pleasure to be back in Durham. And sorry, this is a bit noisy. I speak loudly anyway, so probably don't need it. I was here for 7 years, and seven very, very fun and productive years. And it's really nice to be back. So, and thank you all for coming as well. And thank you for the invitation. So I've gauged this talk. This talk is not really a scientific talk. It's more of a talk about meteorites and what they tell us about the solar system in a very, very general way. And I'm going to show you lots of pictures, and I'm not going to show you any XY diagrams or anything that would be vaguely considered scientific. This is an image of Larkin Nunataks taken in 2006. And what we're doing here is we're collecting meteorites on the blue ice of the Antarctic. And as I'll explain to you today, this is where most of our materials, or many of our materials, come from. And I'm going to explain how we collect them, why we collect them there. It's not just for fun. And explain, I'm getting a lot of feedback here. Are you getting feedback?
Yeah.
Maybe I'll just talk like this. Can you hear me? There we go, that's much better. Okay. So, the questions, there are a number of important things that we need to consider with meteorites, and most of you will think of meteorites as being these oddities that you find in gem collections and mineralogy shows and so on. The true importance of meteorites is that they tell us about the formation and evolution of our solar system. And consequently, they tell us about the nature of other extrasolar worlds as well, potentially. And here are just some of the questions that I personally am interested in. So just to give you a bit of background, my interests are in high-temperature geochemistry. That sounds very mundane, arcane perhaps. But basically what I want to understand is how planets evolved to their present day states. And so a number of the questions that are of interest to me in particular are: when did planets form and from what material did they form from? Was that material the same across the solar system or did it differ? What do the long-term histories of planets tell us about our solar system? What do they tell us about, for example, life? And water and volatile contents in planets. Now, these are all very big questions, and they sound very grand, but what it ultimately requires is very detailed knowledge of a whole array of processes that are preserved both in meteorites and remotely when we look at planetary bodies such as the planets in our own solar system. So this is a very holistic approach to understanding planetary processes. And in its most basic guise, we think that the solar system formed in a sort of similar way to these diagrams. And what I've shown here is a sort of by visiting of the formation of a cloud of dust that forms our solar nebula, the collapse of that dust cloud into our present solar system. And then locally within planetary bodies themselves, here I'm showing the Earth and also the Moon, is the evolution of those planets, in the case of Earth, into a metallic core, a silicate crust and mantle, and an atmosphere, and oceans, and so on. So, why should we care about meteorites? Well, they tell us about our solar system and how it formed, and they tell us about the formation of other worlds as well. And they reveal fundamental processes that occur within the planetary bodies that we want to investigate. So the outline of the talk, whoops, I'm just trying to get rid of this, this strange thing here, but I can't seem to get rid of it. The outline of the talk, whoops, is to look at what meteorites are, some need to know. For those of you who maybe know a little bit about meteorites, what are meteorites, why do they differ from shooting stars, what are they different from meteoroids, how we go about identifying meteorites, in case you think you found one, and collecting meteorites, why we go to the hot deserts, the cold deserts of the world to collect meteorites. And then finally, at the end, I'm going to talk a little bit about some of the scientific value of meteorites to give you a sense of why they're so important. So, I'm sure all of you know this, but there's differences between meteorites, meteoroids, and shooting stars. And I often hear people say to me, oh, I found a meteoroid. And I say, well, that's pretty hard, because that it's terminology, but these are the things that occur before they actually impact with the planetary body, in this case, the Earth. So a meteorite is something that we can collect, that we can find, that has landed on the Earth. Whereas a meteoroid is the sort of thing that you might see or envisage is floating around in space. And when that meteoroid hits the Earth's atmosphere, it forms a shooting star. And so just to give you some examples, of course you know them all. Here's a shooting star, beautiful shooting star from the Andes of Borrego, just outside where I live. And here's an example of a meteoroid that became a meteorite. You must have all heard of the Chelyabinsk meteoroid that caused this devastation in the Chelyabinsk region of Russia. Of course, a lot of windows to be smashed, and a huge shockwave as the meteoroid passed through the Earth's atmosphere, leaving us with material that is now known as the Chelyabinsk meteorite. And interestingly enough, or maybe uninterestingly, this meteorite is what we would call an ordinary chondrite. And the reason we call it ordinary is because most of the meteorites that we find are these types of meteorites. About 85% of that. And this particular meteorite has taken a lot of attention, but it turns out it's very, very ordinary. So this is what meteorites can do, or meteoroids can do, rather. And for those of you who have been here, this is Barringer Crater, or Meteor Crater. It's about a kilometer across. And this was formed by a meteoroid that was probably of the order of around 30 meters across. And the meteorite from which this meteorite spalled material is known as Canyon Diablo. And Canyon Diablo has a special place in the cosmochemists' hearts, because this is the rock from which Claire Patterson first accurately dated the age of the Earth by taking the lead isotope composition of that meteorite and comparing it with the composition of the Earth's lead. And so this is a very important meteor scar that occurs in Arizona. There are many other meteor scars, and some of them are very large. In fact, this is something like 276 known and confirmed meteor strikes that have craters on the Earth. Now, the reason that there are so few, if you look at the Moon, for example, you can see hundreds of, and even thousands of these, is because, of course, we have plate tectonics going on the Earth. We have weathering. We have processes that break these craters down, and so their preservation in the geological record is limited. But the ones that do occur, some of them can be very large. The Rutherford structure, which is just about here in South Africa, is 2 billion years old. It's very old, almost half the age of the Earth. And it's somewhere around 300 kilometers in diameter. And then one that you'll be very familiar with is the one that is the dinosaur killer, Chicxulub. This one occurs on the Yucatan Peninsula, just here. It's 65 million years old, which happens to be where most of the dinosaurs saw demise. And this one is about 180 kilometers in diameter. So where do these meteors and their meteorites come from? Well, actually, our solar system is extremely large. as you go out into the Kuiper Belt, we're looking at distances that are about 40 to 100 times the distance of our Sun to our Earth, just to get into that belt. And so the distance between the Sun and the Earth is known as one astronomical unit, and that astronomical unit is 93 million miles. So we're talking about huge distances. But interestingly enough, almost every meteorite that we've found, we think derived from the inner solar system. So that's defined by the asteroid belt here, going in towards the rocky planets, which include the Earth, Venus, twin of the Earth, if you will, Mars and Mercury. And so our knowledge of the composition of the solar system is still controlled dominantly by the materials within the inner solar system. And that's something to bear in mind when we think about what meteorites can tell us, and potentially how we might learn more about the solar system with some of these missions looking at, for example, Pluto, or some of the asteroids that have recently taken place. So it's very important to remember that meteorites give us the physical evidence of what's going on a planetary body, but these remote sensing studies give us an extra level of knowledge that can help us to understand how our solar system formed. So, where do we find meteorites? We find meteorites everywhere, okay? Or we could find meteorites everywhere. Meteorites strike the Earth's surface roughly equally in all areas. So there's an equal probability that a meteorite will smash through this lecture theater as there is that it will land on the blue ice of Antarctica in the next few minutes. Don't be afraid. But in the Antarctic, and specifically in the Antarctic, but also in the hot desert regions, we have one thing that's really going for us, and it's present right here. Can everyone see the meteorite? No? None of you can see the meteorite? Can you see it? Raise your hand if you can see it. You can see the meteorite, right? That's because the difference in the color of the ice and the structure of the meteorite, the meteorite is dark, the ice is high albedo, means that we can spot them from miles away. Now that in itself is great, but I just told you that meteorites land roughly equally across every portion of the Earth. And that, on average, is something like 8 meteorites per day across the entire surface of the Earth. That's not very many. So we've been waiting a very long time on the Antarctic ice to collect a few meteorites. The mechanism that helps us, going the wrong way again, and which allows the meteorites to get condensed, in this moraine, this is a glacial moraine, it's actually an ice sheet moraine, this moraine can contain up to 10,000 meteorites. The reason that this happens, and I'll go straight to it, is because the ice sheet is acting as a conveyor belt to move these meteorites down slope. And so what happens is that the meteorites fall roughly equally across the surface of the Antarctic ice sheet, which is a very big ice sheet. That ice is moving down the slope towards the gravity, towards the ocean. And when it hits the transantarctic mountains, it has nowhere to go. At the same time, you have adiabatic winds that blow onto the South Pole and can reach gust speeds of up to 80 to 100 miles an hour during the summer that actually ablate that ice local to the transantarctic mountains and pre-concentrate massive amounts of meteorites. And that is the primary reason that we go to the Antarctic to collect these meteorites. Another important reason that we go there is because it's a desert. Now that may seem odd to some of you, but it doesn't rain or snow here, at least very little. Any pictures I show you where it looks like there's snow, it's actually wind-blown ice. These are deserts. They see very low precipitation. It's very cold, and so consequently, these meteorites can be preserved for tens to hundreds of thousands of years in the ice. Now, these are the areas that the Antarctic Search for Meteorites has been to. This is the US Antarctic Search for Meteorites. Luckily, they take foreigners like myself. So we're very lucky to go there. And these are the areas we've been to. Just to give you a sense, Ross Island's down here, so Amundsen went in this direction and Scott went in this direction, and we know how that went. And what we've done is we've systematically collected from these regions, and it looks like we collected a lot of meteorites from a lot of areas, but really, the Antarctic search for meteorites has probably covered a fraction of a percent of the available search area. And yet, in the 30 years that it's been going, we've collected something like 40,000 meteorites. So this really is a location where we can really learn something about our solar system. This is just one example of a meteorite. This is one that's near and dear to my heart. It was the first one I ever looked at. It's La Paz Ice Field 02205. Now, we give them wonderful names. Don't you agree? I mean, that's a catchy name. The reason for it is actually it's the ice field. LAP stands for La Paz. 02 is the year it was found. And then 205 is literally the number of the meteorite that was collected. So there were 204 meteorites before it. The important thing about this one is it's from the moon. And so we have rocks from the moon from the Apollo missions, and we have this meteorite and many other meteorites that come from the moon. And the amazing thing about these meteorites and the rocks from the Apollo missions is they're extremely old. They're about 3 billion years to about 4 billion years old. Yet they're as fresh, or fresher, than basaltic rocks. These are basaltic rocks that would erupt in Hawaii today. Because on the moon, there's absolutely no atmosphere. There's no alteration effects, there's no precipitation, nothing to affect these rocks and alter them. And so consequently, these rocks contain all of these crazy phases that we've talked about today in detail, things like sulfides and metals, and they're as fresh as the day that they were crystallized 3 billion years ago. So just to give you a sense of how common or rare meteorites are, I thought I'd give you a sort of brief overview of the distribution of meteorites. Whoops, I don't know what's going on here. Here's just an example of the Antarctic map showing locations of meteorites that come from Mars and come from the Moon. And you can see that they're actually few and far between. In all of these sites, we maybe find one, maybe two of these types of meteorite. I'll explain how these meteorites get to the Earth. But you might be wondering, how do we know, for example, that some of these meteorites come from Mars? How do we know they come from the Moon? Well, the Martian meteorites are particularly interesting because these meteorites have no gas signatures, so these are things like helium, and neon, and argon, that exactly match the noble gas signatures that were measured by the Viking landers. Not only that, they're extremely young. They're much younger than the lunar samples. They're of the order of about 200 million years or less. And the only planets in our solar system that we know have had active volcanism and tectonics are the Earth, most likely Venus, but also Mars. And we also know that these aren't from the Earth because they're oxygen isotope carriers. The amounts of atoms of different isotopes of oxygen in these rocks differ from the Earth. And so this is how we can ascertain where these rocks come from. And so there's a lot of work that goes into proving that these rocks have a heritage on Mars, have a heritage on the Moon, and so on. Now, just to quickly go to the side, the other place that we go to for meteorites are the hot deserts, and it's for the same reason. You can clearly see them, you don't have much precipitation, and those meteorites get preserved very well. The problem with the hot deserts is they don't have this concentration mechanism. There is some wind blowing that occurs that affects these meteorites, but by and large, they land where they land and they stay where they land. And so consequently, this resource is beginning to come depleted. And the reason for that is that many of the tribesmen in these regions, and I'm talking here about Northwest Africa primarily, know the value of these meteorites. And so when you go to Morocco or you go to some of these more dangerous locations, you'll find that if they know that you're a scientist, they'll very quickly want to try and sell you these rocks. And as, by and large, they're right, they are actually meteorites. But unfortunately, this resource is becoming very depleted. So where are these meteorites found? So here's some stats for you. I told you I wouldn't give you XY plots, but pie charts probably okay. Most of them, by and large, come from the Antarctic. Now there's a bias here, because where you go and collect them, obviously you're going to get more meteorites. But this gives you a sense of where most of the meteorites are coming from. This is from 2010. If I were to update this right now, the total number of meteorites worldwide is about the order of 55,000. But the same sort of statistics, most of them are coming from the Antarctic, a large fraction are coming from North Africa, and then here we have North America and everywhere else. And everywhere else includes the UK, and I'll show you some stats for the UK, just in case you're interested. And this shows you something that I haven't discussed, which is falls and finds. Now, a find is as it sounds. If you go to the Antarctic ice and you find a meteorite, that is a find. If, however, you're in Chelyabinsk in 2013 and you see it fall, and you collect that material, that is determined as a fall. And so typically, most people like to look at falls because they tend to be the freshest. They've just literally landed. And so that's when you hear this terminology, this is what happened. Now, if we break down the meteorites into different types, I mentioned that you have ordinary chondrites, and those are classified as stony meteorites. So most of the meteorites we find are actually rocky materials. There's a very small fraction of them that are actually iron meteorites. And these are ones that most of you have probably heard of. These are ones that are made out of pure iron. They're very, very heavy. And these probably come from asteroidal cores, very small planets that formed, or planet sessiles that formed in the asteroid belt. And this just gives you some stats on those. But what's important here is of the stony meteorites, the largest fraction of these things called chondrites, and of those, the largest fraction are these ordinary chondrites. Now, what is a chondrite? Well, a chondrite is an amalgamation of material that was formed very early in the solar system, some of which has been metamorphosed and reshaped, if you will, remelted. But they have the bulk composition that approaches that we measure for the photosphere of the Sun. Now, the Sun contains about 99%+ of the mass of the solar system. And so, by definition, we think that chondrites are the bulk composition of our solar system. And so these are important in their own right, because they tell us something about the very earliest processes that formed our solar system. Within the stony meteorites, there's this very small tranche here, this very small fraction of these so-called achondrites. And these are the ones that will make you a lot of money if you find one. Because, for example, there's this little tiny fraction here called angorites. And one of the angorites, SH9555, I told you they're very catchy names, is selling for something like $6,000 a gram. So, you know, This is we're talking money here. And in fact, this is half the problem we have as scientists, is that these are so valuable that sometimes it's impossible to get some of these rocks. Because collectors want to preserve those rocks to sell. And so often we will face this sort of awkward problem that we can't actually get access to some of these rocks, or it's very hard to get access to enough. These different rock types, these different meteorite types, describe different materials. So these two here, it's called a marsite here, but we call it a Martian meteorite. Lunarites, which are of course lunar meteorites. And then this large range of meteorites here that have these funny names like eucrite, diogenite, howardite, and so on. these are all materials that we think come from small asteroids in the asteroid belt. Okay, so what about UK meteorites? Well, there are 22 definite UK meteorites. If you go on the meteorological bulletin database, it'll say something like 44, but most of them are dubious. Of those, there are a couple I've just picked out here. This is the Hambleton palisite that was found in Scotland by amateur collector. It's a palisite meteorite, which means they really, it looks horrible here, but when you cut them, you have this amazing dichotomy between the metal and these silicate grains called olivine. And when you shine the light through them, you get this beautiful green-yellow color that comes through. It's like a puzzle, a jigsaw puzzle. They're very highly valued by collectors, and they're also very important to us as scientists because they tell us about processes that occur during the formation of planets from material dust coagulating, melting, to form cores and mantles. And most people would consider these palisites, being a mixture of these olivines and silicate materials and metal, to reflect mixing between the core and silicate material of these small meteoroids or planetesimals. They're very old. The ages of these are typically around 4.562 billion years. The solar system formed 4.568. So these formed very, very soon after the solar system actually began to form. This is the Roten 3A. Okay. Nomenclature. We love nomenclature. It's just one of those things. But it's an iron meteorite. It's very dense. And this is the Roten iron meteorite. It was found in 1876. And it's given this classification of 3AB. And the reason for that is that these iron meteorites all kind of look fairly similar. So the way that we define their composition is we look at elements in them. And in particular, we look at gallium, which is an element you may not have heard of, but it's a very useful one for looking at what these meteorites are, and iridium. And since I'm here for the highly siderophile element conference, I feel it's important for those of you who don't know about highly siderophile elements to know that these are precious metals, like gold and iridium. And so we use these so-called highly siderophile elements to classify these meteorites. This meteorite was found in 1876, it's kept in the Natural History Museum, and it has this wonderful texture just here, which is called the Wittmannstatten texture. It's mixtures of different iron alloys that have different proportions of nickel. They're called chemisite and taenite. And this is, you can use these textures to estimate how slowly or fast that metal crystallized in this parent body. It's also engendered other things, and I've got to try this. I just found it on the internet, but there's actually a beer named after this meteorite, so I'm going to have to go and find it. It's quite low content, actually. It doesn't look like a 3AB to me. So, what do you do if you think you found a meteorite? I often get asked this question, and my answer is, be skeptical. When I was in Maryland, I had this guy come in. He goes, I found a meteorite. And I go, oh, great, great, great. So I pick it up, and it's round, and it's very heavy. And so I did some tests on it, and I looked where he found it. And the funny thing is, they'll never tell you where they found it, because they're afraid that you're going to go there and collect it, which is just totally bizarre to me, but anyway. It turns out it was a cannonball from the War of Independence. Which, you know, for a Brit, I mean, this was a real sock in the teeth. And so I said to him, this is fantastic. This is going to be worth a lot. And he went away disappointed because he wanted it so much to be an iron meteorite. That was the only story I had. Everyone else, they brought me some kind of slag or other kind of material. So most of the time, literally one time in 1,000 is the likelihood that what you found is a meteorite if you're not a meteorite expert. So the first thing you do is you don't immediately contact an expert. because most of the time we get sent bad, non-scaled, poorly taken images, and they say, is it a meteorite? Well, I have no idea. It could be a cat for all that. No, the location you found the sample, you don't need to share it with us if you don't want to, although, frankly, we've got a lot of other things on our minds, so it's unlikely we're going to go out there and try and find them ourselves. And any conditions of the sampling location, anything interesting, maybe there's a hole there, or you see a scattering of other rocks that look very similar. That's very useful information. What do real meteorites look like? Just so you can figure it out yourself. Well, this is, I'm going to show you some images, but this is what you should do if you find, if you think you found a meteorite. Is it attracted to a magnet? Yes, it is. Is it heavier than the other rocks? Yes. Sanderside, is the inner color like steel? No, it's not a meteorite. Okay? These are the kind of flowcharts that you need to find. I found this one on the internet. But the point is here, one of my colleagues gets inundated every year. I'm not going to say who it is, because he might get inundated some more, but he gets something like 2,000 requests every year, which is just insane. So this is what real meteorites look like. One of the real characteristics of a true meteorite is a fusion crust. And that's because as it falls through the Earth's atmosphere, it's fallen very, very fast. And so you get friction heating on the outside of the body of the meteorite that melts the outside. Now, the inside doesn't get melted very much because it's coming from near absolute zero of deep space. And so you tend to get this patina of beautiful fusion glass. And in that fusion glass, you get these dimples. And these dimples are known as regnums. If you see this, you stand a very high probability that you found a meteorite. This is what the inside of a meteorite looks like with a black fusion crust on the outside. So very often, you'll see this black, it's almost like the baker has overbaked the bread, and a nice fresh inside, but maybe of a different color, it may not be. Iron-rich meteorites, they're obvious because they're extremely dense. And so when you pick up an iron meteorite, you know about it. And they tend to have these beautiful regnum lips. They don't tend to have fusion crusts because you can't really melt the metal in these iron meteorites. You tend to ablate them rather than melt them. And then this is obviously the same calcite I just showed you with these olivines and metals. This is clearly not a typical rock that you would find on Earth, a very dense rock with this beautiful texture. Many people say, oh, I've got a fascicolated rock that I found in Hawaii. Is it a meteorite? Let me think about that for a second. No. These are not meteorites. This is just a piece of slag from iron workings. This is a fascicolated basalt from Hawaii. Looks like that classic aero bar texture that we know and love. This is a howardite from, we think, the asteroid Vesta that was visited by the Dawn mission couple of years ago. And the reason it has vesicles, these holes, is because it's been sitting on the outside of Vesta for some period of time, probably a billion years or so, absorbing solar wind. And this solar wind is full of hydrogen, it's full of other elements as well. And when these rocks pass through the Earth's atmosphere, they actually expand slowly. And so you get this circulation. And it's very rare, but you can find it. Meteorites. Density of meteorites. Well, most meteorites, strangely enough, are actually of similar density to typical terrestrial rocks you might find. The ones that really are different are these guys, the iron meteorites and the stony iron meteorites, the ones that are made of metal and olivine, for example, like that palisade I showed you. They're extremely dense, of the order of 3 or 4 times denser than a typical limestone, granite, or quartzite. So let's go through some meteorons with you. So these are two objects that I was shown, and the person said, oh, they're meteorites. Definitely, they have to be. They're really heavy. I noticed, strangely enough, the top one is magnetic, the bottom one is not. and their streak is different. That's what happens if you take a ceramic plate and you rub it against a ceramic plate. You get this color, and the colors came off as gray for this one and red for this one. So are they meteorites? Sadly not. These are actually hematite and magnetite. And these are very common terrestrial minerals. And so one thing to bear in mind with meteorites is that they contain very little of these types of minerals, in fact, almost none. And they typically don't contain quartz, mica, calcite, these two elements, because of the way that they were formed. And I'll go through a little bit about how they formed, but these are typically not minerals you would expect to find in a meteorite. So I'm going to show you pretty pictures. Here's two iron meteorites. This is Canyon Diablo. It's very characteristic because this meteorite has these rusted out sulfides. So these are made of sulfur, iron sulfides, in this metal. And you can see that Bindenstatten texture. Here's a beautiful palisite with these greenish, rusty olivines here. And then this is a meteosiderite, which is probably some kind of weird impact rock that occurred on an asteroid. This is a piece of industrial slag, and just in case, I often see these as well. They do contain metals. Of course, you're going through a smelting process. You're using carbon to reduce the metal, and so you get metal in these slags, but they are slags, and you can tell that because they contain vesicles, they have glass, not crystals, and they contain often bits of local rock and carbon, of course. Okay, so now we all know how to collect meteorites, let's talk about collecting meteorites. So collecting meteorites on the ice is as close to a religious experience for me as I'm going to get. And the reason for that is you're out on the ice with 8 people for 2 months, and you don't see anyone else. In fact, you don't hear from anyone else. So you get to know them quite well. It's kind of funny, it's like a social group. You have your different tents and you invite each other over for dinner and it's all very sociable. It kind of reminds me of one of those soap operas, I suppose. But when we find the meteorites, we're all absolutely in reverence of these things because they've fallen from space, they're very ancient, and each one tells you something different about the origins of our solar system. And so you can see that all of us are clustered around this particular meteorite, which is an impact breccia meteorite from a small asteroid. It was a beautiful meteorite. There you go. See, I mean, unfortunately, I've got older now, and my beard gets better than this, but the meteorite is what we should look at here. And the meteorite, this is what they typically look like. They're typically preserved on the blue ice, where you have ablation of the ice. And they range from this kind of dark-looking material to very light-colored rocks with fusion crust. And you often find what look like chunks of coal. And these chunks of coal are known as carbonaceous chondrites. They literally look like a chunk of coal. You walk up and you go, oh, someone's dropped some coal out in the middle of the Antarctic. No, these are the very primitive meteorites that actually mimic this photosphere of the sun almost exactly, with a few exceptions. So this shows you how easy it is to spot meteorites, or at least some meteorites. Can you all spot a meteorite? Where is it? Is it here? Direct me. This is an ordinary chondrite, it's very easy to spot. The ones that are really difficult to spot are actually the ones we want, and these are the achondrites, or at least I'm most interested in, because they look just like terrestrial rocks, except they might have some fusion crust. So what you'll see is, this is a moraine, you'll see people crawling around on their hands and knees looking for these things. It's, quite fun to watch. And they range from the large, this is actually not the largest we found, it's the largest we collected. Some of them are so massive, we just took a GPS location and said, okay, maybe we'll come back and collect it someday. I mean, they're literally 2 or 3 tons. This is a large ordinary chondrite, and they range to the very small. This is actually a Martian meteorite, and strangely enough, most of the egg complex, the Martian meteorites, tend to be on the smaller side, probably because they break up during entry into the Earth's atmosphere more easily. Logistics on the ice, just to give you a sense of how tricky it can be, we have to carry all of our fuel, so this is about 1,000 kilograms of fuel, and we tow it in on our skidoos, and I think this day it was something like minus 60 and about 80 mile an hour wind, so it's pretty unpleasant. But you can see that we tow it all in. And how do you get to a remote field site? And I always think this is the coolest part, because you get in with the US Reserve Air Force. And you feel, I mean, it's quite an experience, because they don't stop the Hercules. They just keep it running the whole way. So you have to drive off like, Knight Rider. You feel like there should be that music going on as you're going off. And you zip off on your skidoo like this. So it's just lightweight, right? You go backwards. And then the really spectacular thing is they then take off with JATO rockets, which are these rockets that launch the Hercules. And so they just puff up plumes of ice as they take off, you know, and leave you for 8 weeks. This is what a skidoo looks like. This is the contraption we use. So just to give you a sense of the weather conditions, this is a picture that my colleague took, and this is known as a sun dog. I don't know if any of you have seen this before, but I'm standing here on a very large sastrugi. It's actually known as a gargoyle, and they're actually empty void space. So underneath my feet, if I had smashed my hammer into there, I'd have fallen 40 feet onto the blue ice. But he wanted this picture because what this is the sun, the light of the sun is coming through, and it's refracting off ice in the atmosphere, forming this beautiful sun dog effect, which this was taken at midnight. So the weather gets pretty bad there, and in fact what we found is that we'd actually blow meteorites to the tents. So we'd get up in the morning and go, oh, there's a meteorite outside. Isn't that nice? But it gets pretty bad, and so we had about, on this particular trip, we had something like 11 days of just sitting in. And you can't go outside because you could get lost. So you have to do everything in the tent, which, as you can imagine, is pretty awkward. This is what happens when you have a tent there for a couple of weeks. You get about 4 to 6 feet of windblown ice behind your tent, and you have to dig it out, unfortunately. It took about 6 hours. Okay, and the things to do on the ice, I figured this would just here, but we made a clock because we wanted to know the time, so that seemed obvious. We decided we'd do a bit of sailing. I mean, why not? Lots of wind, good direction, you can tack. This is Matt Genge, who any of you might know, and he's an expert sailor, so he really had this thing going fast. He reckoned he did about 40 knots at one stage. Maybe it's like the fish is this big, but pretty impressive. And then I was fortunate enough to go with an astronaut on this trip. His name's Don Petter. He's been into space station 2 or 3 times. And talking with him makes you realize how important it is to recognize that meteorites on their own are not the only contribution to this form of science, that we can use all kinds of observations. And he was here to compare the experience he has on the space station with the experience he had on the ice. And he found it to be very similar, if you see Tommy so. And this guy, he brewed beer on the ice. It was very nice. It's pretty difficult to do, actually. He built his own motor and ran all of his electronics with an ice fan. And he made, which I think was the best thing, a didgeridoo out of ice. And the best part of it is I said, well, you're going to freeze the ice. It's minus 28. He goes, butter. So he had a butter mouthpiece. And he actually made some good music. And on space station, he's actually the dentist. So when Cliff here had a bad tooth, Don actually pulled it out. And you can see one satisfied customer after all of that. Now, this brings an important point up, which is that we can use laboratory experiments on the Earth, but we can also use laboratory experiments in space to understand the processes of planet formation. One of those processes is volatile ocean. So on the Earth, we have an atmosphere. We have an escape velocity of about 11.4 kilometers a second, which is good for us, which means that when we jump, we don't go flying off into space. But the downside of this is we can't do a lot of experiments that you can conduct in space. And so one of the goals of Don's trip was also to try and engender experiments that they could use on space stations. So the weirdest one of all is he came to SCRIPPS last year and said, "Do you have an octopus specialist?" And I said, "Yeah, you know, we've got loads of them." And he goes to the lady and he says, "I want to take one of your octopi into space." She's looking at me going, "What?" Anyway, by the end of this conversation, he had already figured out that he could build a kettle out of seawater. He can make artificial seawater and have the kennel for the octopus. And the idea is to, in space, we kind of think about Star Trek and all these other kind of these sci-fi movies where they have these big metal objects, but you don't need these kind of controls in space. And so the argument is that, in fact, if you use pneumatic controls in space, you might be able to use them to more easily fly spacecraft and things like this. And so he wanted to use an octopus to demonstrate. Anyway, I thought this would be a gratuitous reason to show what I think is one of the best movies, and I thought it would be important to show you a movie rather than listening to me talk. Let's see if I can get out of this. And this is a film that he shot from the space station. He said I can use in my talks, so I've been using it. I'm having great difficulty getting out of this. Let's see.
Escape.
I've got it. No, I haven't. Why is this not moving? Okay. This is not working. Let's see if I can find it. Okay, so this is just to give you a sense of what he sees as.
Holding.
it's mesmerizing. I think it really nicely complements what we talk about when we talk about meteorites and we think about the solar system, the origin of the solar system. We think about experiments that we might conduct to better understand the solar system. And in fact, we have an amazing resource in the International Space Station for exactly conducting those types of experiments. Anyway, what makes things, I'm going to finish up now because I notice I'm running out of time. What makes these rocks so scientifically valuable? Now, I could pick one of 10,000 things, but I decided to pick a few, just to give you a flavor. These are the questions that I mentioned very early on in the talk. What, when do planets form and from what materials? What are the long-term histories of planets tell us about our solar system? How can meteorites resolve that issue? And what makes the Earth so special? Where did the water come from? And what conditions led to our dynamic planet today? So meteorites can inform us, as you probably gauged, about the composition of planetary bodies. Not just whether they have a core or a crust or a mantle, but also how that body evolved. For example, when did the moon last see volcanism? When did the moon form? How did the moon form? Meteorites can inform us on all of those processes. Mars, how and when did volcanism occur on Mars? Did Mars undergo a similar process of formation as planet Earth? Did Mars have plate tectonics, like the Earth? And we can look at meteorites that come from asteroids to understand the very earliest stages of the formation of planetary bodies. And the reason for that is because planets don't just get born big immediately. They get formed out of larger and larger bodies. And so if you want to understand the chemistry of the planet, you have to understand the processes that go into making the materials that form the planet. And so from that reason alone, looking at meteorites from asteroids is also very important. Now this is the asteroid 4 Vesta. And these are some beautiful images taken from the Dawn mission. And the asteroid 4 Vesta actually has some of the most meteorites coming from it. They're called the diogenite meteorites. And I think the cutest thing about Vesta is that it has this snowman on it. They named it after the snowman. And one of the things that I think is very wonderful about planetary science is this kind of ability to give fun and interesting names like the love heart on Pluto. It tells us about impact processes because, as I mentioned to you, we found an impact melt rock on the Antarctic. This is very similar, one might imagine, to what happened when Deep Impact struck Temple 1 about 10 years ago. There was a mission to see what the interior composition of asteroids were made of. And the way they did that was they plunged a projectile into Temple 1, and they got this amazing spectacle of this plume, almost like an explosion, but not quite, that they were able to measure the composition of the comet. But they'll tell us about impact processes as well. They also tell us about the structure and composition of our solar system. And these are just various asteroids that you can see by remote sensing. This just gives you a size of the asteroid, for example, Vesta, compared to the moon. They're quite small compared to the moon. But they have different compositions, these so-called types. And these are very important because they actually tell us about the gross structure of our solar system. So if we take, for example, the asteroids in the main belt, the line between Mars here at 1.5 AU, or about 150 million miles or so, and Jupiter, we actually see that there's a gross structure shown here by this frequency of these asteroids and their compositions. And as it turns out, that structure reflects the structure of our own solar system, at least to a broad degree. And that is because these particular types of asteroids are volatile poor, they don't have much water. And these are volatile rich. So, at a basic level, this combination of remote sensing of asteroids and also the meteorites that we think come from them can tell us about the gross structure of the solar system. Now,
This is a poor diagram, but this is a highly siderophile element conference, and I thought it would be remiss of me not to mention highly siderophile elements, since many of you are here for that. And the reason that highly siderophile elements are so powerful, these are these elements like gold, but also these more perhaps unfamiliar elements to some of you, like osmium, iridium, ruthenium, rhodium, platinum, palladium, green. These elements like to go into metal, preferentially to silicate. So in other words, if you have a body that's made out of chondritic material, what we think the bulk solar system is, these particular elements, these highly siderophile elements, will get sucked in to these metallic cores. And so one might imagine that the mantles, the crusts of our planets, would be devoid of these elements. But in fact, they're not. It turns out, of course, many of you are probably wearing gold rings or platinum rings. There is actually an overabundance of these elements in the silicate earth, in the crust and the mantle of the earth. And the reason for that, we think, is because material was added to the earth after the formation of the core. And this is known as late accretion. And basically this shows it. You have your planet accreting from materials, it forms the core. That core stops forming, and everything that's added after that is your late accretion component. And this is important because this late accretion component has been associated intimately with the addition of volatiles, and I'm talking here about water. And so if we can understand the behavior of these elements, for example, we might be able to understand how the Earth is so volatile rich, why we have water, why we have complex molecules that are formed out of hydrocarbons. So this hopefully gives some of you who are at this conference a flavor of why we're talking about these particular elements and their importance. And then finally, I just want to briefly mention two very unusual rocks that are near and dear to my heart. They look like sort of rusty, melted bricks. They were found in the Antarctic. And these are very unusual meteorites because they're composed predominantly of a mineral called oligoclase, which is a sodium-rich feldspar. If any of it's calcium, aluminium, silicate, or in this case, a sodium, aluminium, silicate. And they're very unusual because they look just like the composition of the Earth's crust. And that's weird because they shouldn't. And the reason that this is because we think that some asteroids were actually quite wet when they formed. And so we actually believe that in some cases, we find asteroids like this one here, this is Ida, that forms perhaps something not quite like this, but certainly similar to the Earth's crust. So I think what I want to end up with is saying that we're finding new and unusual discoveries in the meteorite collection all the time. And they're opening our eyes to processes that we never really thought were possible. And so this is why the continued value of meteorites and the collection of meteorites remains important today. And with that, thank you very much for your attention, and I'm open to any questions. I was going to mention that, sorry. What is the major geological process? Do you know? When you think about geology, what do you think about? Do you think about volcanoes? Yeah, erosion, maybe? As well, yeah. Actually, the major geological process is impact. Why do I say that? Because you have to form planets through the impact of the materials. And so, the reason that this material gets taken off a planet is because of impact. For example, if you look at Martian meteorites, Mars has an escape velocity about just a little under half the Earth. So it's still quite a lot. You need a lot of energy to take something off Mars. And so what we actually find with Martian meteorites is that all of this mineral called plagioclase, or almost all of it, has been turned to a glass. It's called the Skeller, after the guy who discovered it. And the reason for that is because they've been shocked heavily by impact. And so what happens is the impact strikes the surface of the planet, presumably evaporates or vaporizes large fractions of it, but some fraction gets ejected off in the other direction. And so there are complex models for this, or models for how this impact ejection takes place. And believe it or not, they think that you could actually eject meteorites off the Earth, even though we have a very high escape velocity, 11.2 kilometers a second. And so that's the mechanism by which we get meteorites. And one of the really exciting ideas is that we might actually have Earth meteorites that occur, for example, on the Moon. And the reason that that's important is we don't know very well the geology of the very early Earth. So some people have argued that we should go to the Moon to look for terrestrial meteorites to tell us about the very earliest stages of Earth's evolution. It's an interesting idea, but it's certainly a good idea. Yes, sir?
You mentioned at the beginning the possible connection between the Chicxulub crater 65 million years ago and the death of the dinosaurs. Do you really believe it? I think it's rather far-fetched. If you look at the evidence, which we spent a lot of time doing, it's rather poor. There are no other mass extinctions out of the 50 major ones in the past 500 million years that have an associated crater or whatever. Perhaps you would say, well, they needn't have because only a third of the lowlands hit the Earth, the rest go in the ocean. How do you feel about it? Have you studied it?
I personally, I do have an opinion on it, so I'll give you my opinion. And that's the time that the dinosaurs became extinct was a period of strong climatic change on the Earth. And we know that from the record of marine chemistry. And so when we look at the sediments within this period of time, we know that a lot of interesting things were happening. For example, at about that same time, the Deccan Traps in India were erupting huge amounts of sulfur dioxide and carbon dioxide into the atmosphere. Now, there's been a huge argument about whether the Chicxulub impact was the thing that caused the demise of the dinosaurs, and many people have shown that dinosaurs, for example, in the geologic record in Alaska, post-date that event. But the way I would see it is this. If you already have a very stressed climatic system, and you have an event like this taking place, it's as if the straw broke the camel's back. And so I think there's very strong scientific evidence that the coincidence of this event with the demise of these particular animals, but I think there's a great deal more to learn about how exactly this event took place. And I do think it probably played a role of some kind. Now, the last other major mass extinction event that we know of is the Permo-Triassic event, where about 90% of marine organisms became extinct. And that was directly associated with the Siberian Traps, which is another big volcanic province. And so, these are very important because we ourselves today are stressing the climate system. And so one might argue that we should take careful heed of what happens during this kind of process and try to understand what exactly causes this huge climatic change, whether it is Chicxulub or whether we need some other kind of mechanism to explain it. So I think I don't know if I've answered your question directly, but I certainly think that there's a role to play in these types of impacts.
There's almost as much energy liberated, if that's the word, from the volcanic activity that they can in India, of course. Right. But you might say, well, the volcanoes went off because of the impact.
I guess the biggest problem, of course, is that we have this iridium anomaly, you're probably familiar with, and that cannot be explained by the death. Any other questions? Well, thank you. Oh, one more.
I love your picture of the
a great question, actually. Yeah, that's a great question. So, I've two lines of evidence to give you. So, the first one is snowball Earth. This is the idea that the Earth is covered in ice. This feedback mechanism led to the Earth getting slowly, progressively cooler, and leading to literally Earth covered in ice. And people have actually looked for meteorites in the tillites that form in the snowball Earth, with limited success, as far as I'm aware. But that would be one place to look, because you've had ice for a few million years. We know that there was ice movement, because otherwise you wouldn't get tillites. And so that's one possibility. The other one is that there's a location in Sweden, the name of which I completely forget, has a Swedish name. And they've actually found meteorites in sediments that are now sandstones. And there's been a lot made of these meteorites because they're Ordovician in age, they're 400 million years old, sediments. And so that those particular studies suggest subtle differences between the population of materials that were impacting the Earth then and those that are impacting the Earth today. So yeah, it's a great question. It's certainly worth thinking about, but I certainly won't be spending the rest of my time looking for them. All right, well, thank you very much for your attention.